I left a book with a note for you.
Thank you. Thanks.
Well, welcome everybody to the Council on Foreign Relations. I'm Richard Haass, but more important, the gentleman next to me is Ted Alden. And he is the author, Edward Alden, will be formal. And he is the author of this new book, Failure to Adjust, How Americans Got Left Behind in the Global Economy. Timing counts for a lot in life. It was Woody Allen who said, 80% of life is showing up. Maybe 81% of life is timing. And timing on this is painfully good. At least good for the author, if not good for the country. And so congratulations.
Thank you.
Books are an important part of what it is we do here. I think they're important in their own right. But one of the reasons we've so emphasized them is books require a depth of analysis and a commitment to a subject that in and of itself can produce something really worthwhile, but also it then provides raw material for all else, for shorter pieces, for commentary, and the rest. And Ted has really been the principal person at this institution now for how many years?
Almost 10.
Almost a decade. Yeah. Dealing with this nexus of issues. In some ways, it actually expands what a lot of us have traditionally thought of as international relations or foreign policy or the sort of work you might expect from the Council on Foreign Relations. But he has, over the years, dealt with issues like immigration, infrastructure, debt, and so forth. And here we are now dealing with, what another category might be, globalization and its discontents and the difficulties we as society and as individuals, both as individuals and collectively, have had in dealing with the relentless pressures. So we're going to talk about it for a few minutes, and then I'm going to open it up to you all. It's on the record, by the way. But again, Ted and I will start. Let's talk about the title, which is not so much the failure to, well, we can talk about both sides, but failure to adjust, and then the subtitle, How Americans Got Left Behind in the Global Economy. Failure to adjust means exactly what? What adjustment has not been made adequately?
The title is a bit of a poke at economists, actually. Economists talk about the adjustment costs of different sorts of shocks. And the U.S. entry into a more competitive global economy, which has sort of occurred over the course of our lifetimes. You go back 50 years, the United States didn't trade all that much with anybody. Just not because we were a closed economy, but because we didn't need to. We made everything better than everybody else. Sorry?
Because we also were a continental.
Yeah, exactly. So I mean, this has really been a modern experience for the United States, and there were going to be adjustment costs associated with that. And what that really means in economic language is people are going to lose their jobs, they're going to need to find other ones, they're going to need to acquire new skills to prosper. I mean, we also understand the idea of comparative advantage. Some places are going to do things better than others. And if you happen to be someone who is working in an industry, say, textiles and apparel, that's one of the industries that a high-wage economy is going to lose in a more competitive global economy. What's going to happen to those people? How are we going to deal with those dislocations? And we as a country have really done a rather poor job of that, even though, and the place I start my book is, we were aware this was coming.
Sure.
Like, this is a Category 4 hurricane, and you could see it on the horizon. And yet we didn't batten down the hatches. We didn't make the preparations we needed to make.
Well, all the order I just had for conducting this conversation just got blown out the window. So, mainly because I won't remember to ask the question I want to ask you now if I park it.
Yeah.
If it was a Category 4 hurricane and the weatherman or woman was reporting it and saying it's going to hit us in X amount of time, why didn't we prepare for it? It's not as though it was a surprise.
I think a lot of, and this really, I think, is a failure of American leadership, not just political leaders, but business leaders as well. I think we had a habit of mind that said, look, at the end of the day, we're the most competitive economy in the world. I mean, you go back to the 1960s, and the most enthusiastic interest group supporting globalization was the labor unions. Right? They looked out to the world and they said, look, our American workers are better than any other workers. American companies are better than any other companies. We generally have low trade barriers. Other countries have high trade barriers. if we do these trade deals, it's going to be a great thing for the United States because it's going to open up new markets. There was a real failure of imagination on the part of the people whose livelihoods really got most disrupted by what came. And I think this was a general kind of society-wide problem. This memo that I start the book off with, written by Pete Peterson, who's obviously got some association with this institution, really is trying to
meeting
sort of
here in Peterson.
Exactly.
Coincidentally.
Coincidentally. It was actually a slightly unfortunate coincidence for my book. But this memo is pretty amazing. You know, written in 1971, called The United States in a Changing World Economy, a memo to President Nixon that says, you know, basically trying to kind of take the president by the lapel and shake him and say, look, we are moving into a different world. The Germans are back, the Japanese are back, there are other countries that are coming. We are going to have to play this game differently than we've been accustomed to playing it for the last quarter century. And if we don't, there are going to be some severe consequences.
Okay, but the subtitle is How Americans Got Left Behind. But the United States, we haven't done so badly. So I don't mean to be harsh or unfeeling, but even if individuals in some cases got left behind, it's hard to make the argument that the United States collectively has gotten left behind.
Yeah, and I wouldn't. And, you know, honestly, I suppose if it were Truth in Advertising, the subtitle would have been how some Americans or how many Americans got left behind in the global economy. So obviously lots of Americans have done very well. You know, if you look at the most competitive companies in the world, you know, our Googles and Facebooks and Intel's, Microsoft's, Boeing's, we've got, you know, the lion's share of the world's most competitive companies. We haven't done bad as an economy. Our growth rates are generally stronger than they have been in Europe. But there are significant parts of the country, and we learned that in November, that really have been left behind and were hit very hard. And that was not a surprise, should not have been a surprise. You know, if you read The Economist, they say, look, trade has broad benefits and concentrated costs. And the broad benefits have been real ones. I'm very much in favor of trade. But the concentrated costs were also real, and we didn't pay a lot of attention to those.
Okay, so let's deal with two separate issues, because one you just gotten at. Trade has broad benefits and concentrated costs. There's a law of American politics which is based upon just that. Some people call it intensity. And the problem is if benefits are widely felt, but they're thin, and the costs are narrowly located, but they're felt with great intensity, often those smaller numbers with greater intensity prevail in a society over larger numbers with preferences, but not great intensity. Is that the case here?
I mean, I think that's not an unreasonable judgment, but I wouldn't want to go from that to say, well, because generally as Americans, you know, we've done well from trade, like consumers, right?
Yeah.
Families used to, in the early 1970s, spent 6% of their household income on clothing. It's 3% now. That's a great thing for all Americans. It's a great thing particularly for the poor who don't have to spend as much money on clothing. We have access to the global markets. Generally, as I said, our company's done really well. A lot of benefits from trade. But there also are people, particularly in the country's manufacturing industries, who got hit really hard. I mean, we lost 6 million manufacturing jobs in this country in the 2000s. That is a big number, 6 million manufacturing jobs. And you have to think what those jobs were for a lot of people. A lot of those were unionized jobs where people with modest levels of education could make good, solid, middle-class salaries. And when those jobs disappeared, there was nothing for them to fall back on. There was unemployment or Social Security disability or jobs at the Walmart. And so the impact on those individuals and more broadly on their communities, you know, when you lose the factory, it's not just the factory jobs that go, it's the restaurant jobs and the bowling alley and the gas station and all the sort of local services that don't compete internationally but are dependent on the paychecks that go to the men and women who work in those factories. So those effects are pretty significant. I don't want to minimize those.
So to what extent, though, was trade the culprit? To what extent were these jobs victims of trade, or to what extent were these job losses much more the victims of productivity increases that essentially eliminated jobs full stop, rather than necessarily because of cheaper imports coming, you know, flooding in across the border?
Yeah. I mean, I have three answers to that, but they will all be really short. First, if you had to add it up, technology is obviously the bigger culprit. You know, maybe 75%, maybe 65%. The majority is technology. I mean, don't forget also changing consumer preferences. We don't buy as much stuff as we used to. We consume more services, you know, restaurant meals and other things. So that's one. My second point is I sometimes think it's a bit of a false dichotomy. Think about trade and technology. So you think, you know, if you're a US textile company. You're suddenly facing cheap imports from Mexico or from China or somewhere else. You've got kind of two options. One, you just can't meet the competition, and so you go out of business and your employees lose their jobs. The second possibility is you have to get a lot more productive. And how do you do that? You invest in technology, you invest in machinery. Some of your employees lose their jobs. That's better than all of them losing. But that's, so is that a job loss to technology or to trade? Well, it's a bit of both. And then my third response is, for the people affected, it doesn't really matter. And it shouldn't matter. We shouldn't have a trade adjustment assistance program to help people get harmed by trade. We should have an adjustment assistance program to help people who get dislocated for a whole variety of reasons to land back on their feet.
But even if it doesn't matter for individuals, because you're right, and we'll come back to what traditionally was called TAA, Trade Adjustment Assistance, it matters for us as a country carrying out a foreign policy. Yes. Because to the extent you have, how would I call it, the causality or attribution defined as mostly trade, when you're arguing it's more technology, our public policy is inconsistent with your conclusion.
And I wouldn't argue with that. And that's one of the reasons we're talking about this at the Council on Foreign Relations, because trade is a lot more than just an economic issue. It's been a critical part of U.S. foreign policy for decades now. It's obviously been a good thing for an awful lot of the world. If you look, more people have been brought out of poverty worldwide in the last two decades than in any other comparable period of human history. So trade has a lot of benefits associated with it for the United States. But again, getting back to where I started with the hurricane coming, people who were writing about this in the 70s and 80s and 90s said, look, if we don't get on top of this problem, people are going to blame trade. Even if trade is only a part of the story, people look for something to blame. And they also look for things they can control. It's hard to say you can control technology, right? Mm-hmm. Do we want to stop making better iPhones? Well, probably not. But people look at trade and they say, well, in theory, we could stop imports, right? So that's something the government can do. That's some way the government can help us. So it's not surprising trade ends up in the sights, even if it isn't the primary culprit.
So essentially you're saying trade is, to some extent, being scapegoated.
No question.
For other things. I see Steve Brill in the audience. To what extent is some of our problems self-inflicted? It's not that others are better at introducing certain technology. It's not necessarily always that others have lower wage scales. It's not necessarily that others are carrying out unfair trade practices, but we have extraordinarily high, for example, healthcare costs that have made us uncompetitive in certain areas of manufacturing.
I would say it's both. I mean, my book is kind of half about the rules, and I think there have been problems with the rules. I think that China in particular was an enormous shock to the global trading system, both because of its size and because it's an economy that's just constructed differently. I mean, the WTO global trade rules were built largely for economies where the bulk of production was in private hands. So we have a private sector. Well, in China, the bulk of production is in state hands, and a lot of those companies are heavily subsidized. And China's entry into the world trading system, again, for all the benefits it brought China, and I think by and large it was inevitable that China was going to come in, was very distorting for the world economy. The United States didn't push back very hard, neither did other countries. We let the currency stuff go on far too long. I mean, we're having this bizarre debate about currency manipulation now at a time when the Chinese are actually trying to prop up their currency. But 10 years ago, it was a real issue. The Chinese were artificially devaluing to gain a competitive advantage. There were rules against that sort of thing. And we didn't do very little to counter it. So there are issues on that side. But that said, and again, going back to the Peterson memo, he said, look, the biggest part of this challenge is at home. It's about investing in research and development. It's about infrastructure. It's about education. It's about worker retraining. I don't think he mentioned healthcare, but we could certainly say today, healthcare costs is a component of it. It's about making sure we are set up to be the most competitive investment location we can be. I should have thrown in corporate taxes, where we now have the highest rate among the advanced.
Maybe not.
So yeah,
maybe
so there's a lot of self-inflicted stuff. Yeah, absolutely.
You've now mentioned several times adjustment assistance. And I can't remember, but back when we did some work here on it, you did some, Bob Zelick did some, and my memory is probably failing me. I think if I remember reading one point, we had something like 17 separate adjustment assistance programs at state and federal levels.
I think it's even more than that.
Okay, yeah. Okay, whatever it is, it's a lot. Yeah. We're throwing, historically, tens of billions of dollars a year at it. Are we not getting a return on investment?
Well, I mean, to be clear on the numbers, we don't actually throw all that much money at it. Yeah. If you look at this, the category the OECD calls active labor market programs, which are programs that essentially help people train for new careers. If their job is disappearing in a sector where they're not going to get reemployed. The United States spends 0.1% of its GDP The average in Europe is five times that much. In Denmark, it's 2% of GDP. I mean, it's an enormous number, not a number we're ever going to reach. But first, we don't spend very much on it. And secondly, I think we don't spend it very well. There have been some improvements in recent years. I mean, this should be done in very close coordination with the private sector, with companies that are creating jobs, they have demand for certain skills. We have this bizarre situation where, despite the loss of 6 million manufacturing jobs and all those workers presumably looking for new ones, we have a skills shortage in manufacturing. There are a lot of jobs that manufacturers
can't fill. We have millions of jobs now going back.
Millions of jobs that can't be filled because we don't have employees who have the right set of skills. So that's a major fail. And part of that, I think, involves much closer work between government and the private sector, a lot of which should happen at state level, not at the federal level, because federal government just doesn't do those programs all that well. So some of it is a failing of the specific programs, but some of it is actually a money issue. We don't actually spend a whole lot on it.
What else would help? You mentioned infrastructure. Yeah, we haven't talked much about immigration. If you were designing, so besides spending more and spending it more wisely for adjustment assistance, what would be on essentially in your cookbook, your recipes, for making, not for, I never use the word solve, but for making this a less acute situation? What other kinds of things would you do?
You know, I would argue as a country we should compete more aggressively for investment. I mean, it's why I wasn't entirely sorry to see the whole carrier thing with Trump, where Trump's sort of saying, look, we care about jobs here in the United States, and we're going to fight for that, and you know, even if we have to pay a small bribe to carrier. The fact is, all countries are doing this. You know, the incentives game is a worldwide game. So I think the United States needs to compete for investment. I would actually like us to try to negotiate rules that constrain the competition within some reasonable bounds so our governments aren't bankrupt and trying to get corporations to invest. But I think we should be competing. We only started doing this at the national level about 10 years ago, and we do it very inadequately. Obviously, infrastructure is hugely important, and it's depressing that we're still talking about it, right? Because we've been talking about this for a decade or more, how the U.S. is falling behind. And it's not just a quality of life issue. It's a competitiveness issue. You know, deepening our ports, improving our rail system so we can get our products to market efficiently. I do think the corporate tax system is a real problem on the investment front. I think, again, an overhaul is desperately overdue. On the trade policy front, and I could keep going on a big list, but I would like to see much closer coordination between state and local economic development officials and our national trade policy. We have this weird situation where trade policy is made at the level of Washington. The inputs all basically come from the corporate lobbyists. You know, we let the union sit at one of the tables. But if you actually look at what are the entities in this country that are busy trying to attract investment and create jobs, it's state and local economic development agencies. But they have no voice in Washington. Let me take an example. You know, if you're trying to build a solar industry, in the state and local officials say, you know, we've got real prospect here. If the Chinese are dumping solar panels far below cost, so there's no chance for an American industry to compete on a level playing field, that's got to work its way up to Washington and trade policy. So I talk about mechanisms to really give state and local authorities a bigger voice in the making of federal trade policy. So those are some of the things I talk about.
Would you actually have states allowed to make more of a state trade policy, or is that something that better left to the federal government with greater state influence?
I wouldn't have states writing rules. You can't do that. You've got to do that at the federal level. I mean, we can't even do that. Congress, in theory, under the Constitution, has the authority for that, but it delegates it to the administration. So you've got to have a single rules place. But in terms of investment promotion, export promotion, a lot of states do that, and I think that's a good thing. They should do more of it.
This is not, a lot of what you're talking about is not unique to this country, actually. I mean, given Brexit, and given what we're seeing in particular in other developed countries in Europe, because you mentioned before some European countries, for example, spend much more on adjustment assistance per capita, whatever measure yardstick you want to use. But are there other things that you're seeing elsewhere that either are better than what we're doing, or are you seeing a pattern where essentially others aren't doing much better at it than we are?
I mean, I think some other places are doing better. I mean, I think the Germans are clearly doing better in a lot of respects. I think the Canadians do better.
But Germans, sorry to interrupt, we often hear about their so-called apprentice program. Yeah. Is that the sort of thing you mean?
I think it works well for them. I'm not saying we can emulate it exactly, but I do think there is a commonality, you know, getting outside of the U.S. experience. I think what's going on in Europe is more of a reaction to immigration than it is a reaction to trade competition. In that sense, it's a little different. If you look at the European complaints about trade, they have much more to do with regulations you know, we don't want to eat American chickens that are bathed in chlorine. But
for the record, neither do we.
It's a very light wash, to be clear, and it deals with a lot of bacteria. But
and it's really good, by the way, with a touch of vinegar. It's really good. So that's good to hear.
I apologize to the American Poultry Association. There's less concern over the sort of wage and economic impacts of trade, but you've seen similar things on immigration. I think the commonality here is the rapid pace of change. And I think what people are saying, and I hope it won't be in an overly destructive way, is we want governments to slow this down a little bit. We want a little more sense of control. I look on the immigration side. Slow down the pace of change, right? We live in an era of very rapid change, rapid technological change, rapid integration in the global economy, high levels of immigration. All of these are kind of dislocating forces. They're very positive in lots of ways. They're positive in terms of generating growth. Diversity obviously has a lot of benefits, but people feel dislocated as a result. And I think what they're saying is we want a level of government control over this. We realize government can't stop the world, make us get off, but they can control the pace of change to a greater extent than they have. I think that's commonality between what's going on here and what's going on in Europe.
At what point does slowing the pace of change become protectionism? At what point does it basically move up? It's almost like a spectrum between being open and being closed. So yeah. If you're dealing with immigration issues, yeah. How does one, if you will, get the Goldilocks position on the right speed of change? It seems to me it's a King Canute-like challenge you're setting up for yourself.
Yeah, except the Goldilocks position is called politics, right? You know, you read Edmund Burke, and Edmund Burke says, you know, politics is how we go about balancing the different demands in society. And if you look at the trade stuff, right, you go back to the vote on the Tokyo Round World Trade Agreement, 1979. The House vote was 395 in favor and 4 against, right? Overwhelmingly, the American people and their representatives are in favor of liberalizing trade. By the time you get to NAFTA, the vote in the House is 234 to 200, and a majority of Bill Clinton's Democrats vote against him. Okay, the people are saying, we're not quite so sure about this anymore. By the time you get to the Central American Free Trade Agreement and the fast-track authority that's needed, the Republicans have to hold the vote open for an hour. Dennis Hastert and Dick Armey, big guys, go around intimidating their Republican members to get on board. I talked to one of them afterwards, Mark Foley from Florida, said it was the worst experience of his life, in order to get the single vote that they needed to get the fast track through the House to allow them to do the Central American Free Trade Agreement. Somebody who's paying attention to politics would say, look, you know, we do not have broad societal support for full speed, pedal to the metal liberalization. Maybe we should slow things down a little bit and listen to what the people are saying.
I was at a meeting the other day, and somebody said the problem isn't trade, it's trade agreements. Because trade agreements, you've actually got to put through the political process. And that's just too hard these days to win that debate. What about essentially structuring trade so the deals and arrangements are below the level where we'd have to introduce them and subject them to the political process?
I don't know. I mean, I think if it's seen as an end run around the political process, you're going to be in trouble. I do think some of the debate over trade agreements is misleading. Look, a lot of this would have happened anyway. This is container shipping. This is the internet. This is modern air travel. I mean, a lot of these are far above politics. But, you know, Mike Froman, the U.S. Trade Representative, has said this. Look, you know, American people won't get a vote on any of that stuff, right? They didn't get to vote on container shipping. They didn't get to vote on the internet. They don't get to vote on air travel. You do get to vote on trade agreements. And so a lot of the anxiety over trade and globalization gets focused on those agreements. And that's just a reality, I think, that politicians have to deal with.
Okay. As you can see, you've got someone who is as well-versed in this as you get. Complex issue, important issue, frustrating issue in some ways. I'll ask one last question while people raise their hands to think. Is there anything that you think could be done? Because there's a frustration, and I'll say it, which is I tend to be one of those who actually thinks on balance trade is better than not, helps more people. I think you would agree. Is this a debate that is lost, or is this a debate that could be done, if certain things were done over time, that this is a debate that could ultimately be, how do I put it, that the eyes could once again have it?
I do, actually. I don't think this is a debate that's lost, but it's going to need to be engaged and recalibrated. I mean, if we're honest here in the United States, we've never had a real debate over trade. You know, I split my time as a young man between the United States and Canada. Canada in the middle of the 1980s, as a result of the U.S.-Canada Free Trade Agreement, you know, linking Canada to an economy 10 times its size, fought a national election over the issue of free trade. It was the issue. It was debated. The Conservative Party won. The Canadians, you know, gave, the Canadian people gave them an overwhelming mandate. And Canada's never really looked back. Canada continues to be a very kind of pro-free trade country. They had a fundamental debate over whether this was good for them or not. We've never really done that in the United States. The closest we came was in 92 with NAFTA and, you know, Pat Buchanan's run for the Republican nomination and the Ross Perot third-party challenge, and then 2016. We've never really had a debate. So we're going to have to debate it. I think one of the things you're going to see happen, you talk about those who get affected. We've heard a lot over the last several decades from those hurt by more open trade, because the prevailing policy has been openness, and we've heard from the losers. If we actually have a president who begins to slap tariffs on imports and disrupt global supply chains, we're going to start to hear from the millions of folks in the United States whose jobs are dependent on trade. And I think you could see a very different debate start to play out. So no, I don't think this debate is done. I think it's just beginning, actually.
Well, that would be one of the ironies of history.
It would be.
Sure, Stephen? Yeah. Wait for, I'm sorry, if people would wait for a microphone and just quickly identify themselves and keep their questions to the point, we'll get as many in as we can.
I'm Stephen Blank, BLANK. And here's a question about adjustment. Okay. Over the years, whether it was New England cloth trades moving south, the guys in New York who unloaded ships, adjustment has worked. More or less people found jobs. Yeah. For the first time, and particularly in this election, we begin to see a core of people who are not moving, who are aging out in place with their kids with them. What are you going to do about this group, these groups of people who seem now to be locked outside of the chance of adjusting, of moving?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a real challenge. So, I mean, I think one of the things we want to do is break down the barriers to mobility. I mean, I think we need to talk about things like, you know, we had it at our national symposium last week. This was on the record, wasn't it, Arena, somewhere?
It was not
on the record, so I won't mention
speak
names.
Speak for yourself.
I won't mention names, but we had a conversation about the issue of creating jobs. And where, what are the big job engines? The big job engines are the cities. Well, the cities are incredibly expensive for people. You know, you have restrictive land use policies that drive up housing prices. And so jobs are getting created, but people can't get to them. Do we need to start talking about that? You look in the wake of the housing crisis, a lot of people got locked into their houses because they were underwater. They couldn't move. There are a lot of things in the United States that have really slowed down labor mobility. You see that in the statistics. One of the reasons adjustment worked well is because people move. They move to follow the job. So that's really slow.
One of the things that came through in that same conversation, who shall remain nameless, I was stunned by the licensing requirements for jobs that one would have thought were below a licensing threshold. So if you want to move from state X to state Y, you have to go through an entire expensive, time-consuming procedure.
Yeah, I mean, we know that for teachers, but it's true for like cosmetologists, people who do makeup. You know, there are hugely expensive and long state licensing requirements, really limiting mobility. So I think we need to get rid of some of those. There are going to be people who want to stay in place. I would argue, and our colleague Bob Lighton has made this argument going back to the mid-80s, for a generous program of wage insurance, for topping up people who move from higher wage jobs to lower wage jobs. If you look at the research done by David Otter at MIT, Gordon Hanson, David Dorn, this trio who've really been revolutionizing thinking about trade's impacts, in these communities that are really hit hard, a surprising number of these sort of middle-aged manufacturing workers who lose their jobs end up on Social Security disability. They go on basically lifetime welfare, which is hugely expensive for us as a country. Why not better off to encourage them back into the labor market, and if they have to go take a $10 an hour job, you top up their wage in a significant way. A lot cheaper for us as a country, keeps people in the labor force, and allows them to stay if they don't want to move. I think we need to be thinking about creative solutions like that on a larger scale.
Susan? Just wait for the microphone.
Susan Kaufman Purcell, from Miami, actually. Glad I'm in town.
Couldn't
you argue, or can you make an argument, that what Trump is proposing, it's a strategic effort to end up setting the groundwork for an ability that or a more welcoming attitude toward free trade, in the sense that, from his people's point of view, the United States is not that competitive. We've got immigration, which drives down the wages. You could make the argument, whether you agree with it or not, of the people who are the multitude of those who are dispossessed. You've got a tax structure that does not make our economy very attractive for investment, thereby making us able to generate fewer jobs than usual. And you've got a horrendous regulatory increase over the last decade or two, which really makes it very difficult for business to prosper, to tell you the truth. Some industries worse than other. So maybe it's possible to look more positively on what he's trying to do. Make America, I don't know, first is the reason, but make America more competitive, and then we can say, all right, now we can participate in more trade agreements because we're able finally to compete. We've gotten rid of our dysfunctional policies.
I mean, I would disagree a bit on immigration if you look at the research, so there are certainly some sectors where I think you do see a wage-lowering impact. But more broadly, I wouldn't disagree with you, and that's kind of my hope. I had an article that came out last weekend that essentially made the same argument that if Trump can move from kind of just bluster and lots of tweets to thinking about national competitiveness, that would be a good thing. And that includes thinking about costs on the tax side, on the regulatory side. It includes thinking about inputs, which I haven't heard much from him yet. You know, do we have the skilled workforce that we need to be attractive? And I'm not even sorry. I mean, I can see the danger in it, and I will be candid that, you know, a lot of my colleagues would probably disagree with me on this. But the kind of shot across the bow to Carrier didn't bother me all that much because, you know, it used to be that American companies had a pretty strong sense of their obligations to the United States, what they meant for the communities they were in, what their sort of broader social obligations were, apart from just returns to the shareholders. And I think we've lost that to some extent. And I would argue even in their narrow interests. I mean, I've made this argument talking to companies that invest a lot in China. I say, okay, look, your concern is expanding in China and taking advantage of the opportunity in that big market. Fine. But when you run into problems, you know, when you run into difficulties with the Chinese stealing your technology or regulatory discrimination or investment discrimination, who's got your back? It's the U.S. government. It's the representative of the American people. And so just for your own long-term self-interest, you should be thinking about always looking for opportunities to invest in the United States, expand your stake in the United States, and make sure you've got the American people behind you because it's in your corporate interest. I mean, look, the Japanese figured that out. When we were bashing them in the 1980s, what did they do? They started opening car factories in Ohio and Kentucky and California, completely changed the whole politics of the issue. Companies need to be thinking about, you know, what's our stake in the United States. So I wasn't sorry to see, you know, Trump knock them on the head a little bit, but we'll see where that goes.
Bill?
Bill Hazeltine. You made a point about local changes that could be state or even more local to the city. In the 1950s, the community around Boston realized that they were exporting all their low-wage shoe and other manufacturing jobs overseas. They responded by a very thoughtful program to use their intellectual capital. They built infrastructure, they created the venture capital business, and that's created a really thriving economy that's blooming in an amazing way today. Yeah. Why did it happen there and not in many other places? It did happen in a few other places, Chapel Hill, Bay Area, very few, but it did happen. Yeah. And so why was it restricted?
That is a good question. There's probably another book in that. I can suggest one variable. There's a fascinating story by my friend Bob Davis in the Wall Street Journal. I think it was yesterday. And it was taking this data set of places that were hit really hard by manufacturing competition and what happened to them afterwards. And the economists broke down this data set and they discovered a pretty striking thing, that manufacturing dependent communities that had a college or university in them did far better. That was a sort of intellectual center around which it was possible to attract more businesses and spin off other positive things for the communities. And places without those college and universities really got whacked. whereas the ones with universities tended to recover pretty well. If you mention those places, you know, the Bay Area, Boston, you know, Raleigh, Durham, these are places with really good and strong universities.
Austin,
you know, Austin being another example. Often this was an inheritance. It's not necessarily something easy to create from scratch, but I think it does tell you that intellectual capital is probably the most important asset for any community. And any way you can kind of nurture that is going to pay dividends. So I wish I had a broader answer, but.
Roger, your talk? It's right behind you, Roger.
First of all, let me just congratulate you. I read your book.
Thank you.
Because the council sent it to me, and it was a terrific book, by the way.
Was it COD or what?
Well, I picked it up on the floor. Somebody else was getting it, so I took it from the mailbox.
Got to keep the business afloat here.
I'm looking out for you.
The check's in the mail. So my question has to do really two parts with trade deals. The whole idea of all of these trade agreements we've had. Now, there's in each, when you think about this, it comes through in part in your book, there's this asymmetry in trade deals. The people who make them are corporate lobbyists, but their interests aren't just the United States. They have plans all over the world. So they're figuring out what is in their, and by the way, they should, but what's in their corporate interest, as opposed to just who's sitting on the side there in terms of the consumer, and what we are, you know, just to keep on, we keep on making the statement, well, Walmart is, you know, we're just getting so many things cheaper. But the reality is we're not. There's big pockets of people that have paid a big price, so when we adjust that Walmart cost for our undershirt, it isn't as balanced as we think it is. So the first part is trade deals and how they're done, meaning who the lobbyists are, what the corporations are, what happens. Second part of trade deals, tariffs, meaning coming from what's happening. There's a 25% tariff on everything we send to China in terms of cars. Our tariffs, I think, are 2.5%. So there's asymmetry in all of these deals that we've done. How do you reconcile that?
I mean, I would argue that's a bit of an overstatement. I mean, just for the record, we have a 25% tariff on all the light trucks we import. It's a leftover from a trade war with Europe in the 1960s. So there are places, actually, where the United States has pretty high tariffs, too. I mean, I understand from the corporate perspective, right? Their responsibility, quite understandably, is to their shareholders. They're interested in doing business globally. They want these deals to make it possible for them to do business globally. I'm not sure that's necessarily a bad thing, right? We live in a world of global supply chains. Companies source from all over the world. And that's just the way things operate now. I really think it gets back to, you know, what do we do as a country to make sure that we have a reasonable share of that? And a lot of that is outside the trade deals. I'm not saying these trade deals have all been perfect. I think one of the ironies is the one that's going to die as a result of what we've seen happen in the ballot box, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, is one of the better ones that we've ever negotiated. I mean, helps in particular, you know, our digital industries, where the United States really is a world leader, and they do create a lot of good jobs in the United States. So, I mean, I don't want to be an apologist for the trade agreements, but I think too much focus is put on them. I think partly because we are a nation of lawyers, we sort of think that the rules can solve everything, right? That if we just write the right rules, everything will work out. I'm much more critical of the failure to enforce those rules in a consistent, effective, and serious way, and the failure to think about what do we need to do as a nation to make sure we prosper within the rules that we've created. Not to say the rules are perfect, but I think they're far from the biggest problem.
Yeah, a lot of people. We're not going to get to everyone, so let me just sort of apologize in advance. Jason, you've been patient.
Thanks, Richard. Thanks, Ted. Great discussion.
Thank you.
One group of dislocated workers that are being retrained at present are people in the military, yeah, who are, there's been a lot of effort in the last 2 years focused on working with the private sector to bring that training into the military environment so that you're getting ready for your new career before you leave your military career. Given all that you've looked at, what would be some advice on how to maximize that kind of program which has very strong bipartisan support?
You know, I'm not sure that my knowledge is quite granular enough. It's always the challenge in these. The challenge in everything we do in the Renewing America Initiative, that when you get down to a certain level, I feel like sometimes I'm you know, you got to talk to someone who really understands how to do training programs on the front line really effectively. But my general recommendation would be to work very closely with the private sector, right? Talk to the folks who are creating jobs and the communities where they are creating jobs and find out what they need and structure the program in close discussion with them. I mean, you know, if you look at Volkswagen in Tennessee, the state set up a whole series of training programs around Volkswagen's investment in Tennessee. And the company basically said, look, anybody who comes through these programs, we're going to hire because we need these folks. And so I think anywhere that you can get that kind of very close relationship between the companies that are hiring and the community college or other training program, I think you're going to be a step ahead of the game, as opposed to trying to look at labor market forecasts and say, you know, we think there are going to be X number of these kinds of jobs, because often those forecasts are way off. So, yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
So, Jordan, how do you feel about guaranteed income?
I'm still wrestling with this, is my honest answer. Andy Stern, who was part of the Trade Task Force, the former Service Employees Union leader, was part of the Trade Task Force we did in 2011, has got a book out arguing for universal basic income. At a gut level, I think it's the wrong way to go. I think it's extremely expensive, for one. Now, if you cut a whole range of other programs, you might be able to do it in some reasonable budgetary fashion. But I also just think work is an essential part of what makes us tick as human beings. And I think it's the way we advance as society. So if I were going to spend my money, I would rather spend on something like wage insurance, where you're topping up people. They're in the market, they're working, they're continuing to acquire new skills, they're trying to advance their careers, but they just can't make enough money to make ends meet. You know, expansion of the earned income tax credit, I think that was one of the best programs created in the last two decades, where you're working, but you, in fact, get rebates from the government for working. I would rather see us expand programs like that than go for a universal basic income across the board. But as I say, I'm still wrestling with it. I'm open to persuasion.
Just so I understand, because I'm not an expert in this.
Yeah.
So you're basically, your preference is for programs that are related to work. It's work plus, if
work
you will,
plus.
As opposed to work instead work.
As opposed to everybody gets $10,000 a year from the government so that even if they can't find work, they won't start.
That was kind of the Switzerland vote that didn't
pass? Yeah, which went down quite dramatically, actually. You got a 70% against. Surprisingly high.
Okay. Yes, sir. Got time for one or two more if people are brisk.
Eric Stein from Eaton Vance in Boston. I read your book, actually bought it on Amazon. One question.
you got two questions.
Okay. Okay, I'm gonna take advantage of that. So first question is, how much of a difference, given that the economy is going more services, Internet of Things, that's all changing, how much difference can a, you know, generally manufacturing goods-based trade deals or enforcing those rules actually do help? And the second question, and you alluded to this in your opening remarks, was a lot of people have gained, consumers, multinational companies, workers in emerging market countries, to the extent under a Trump administration, things are closed down, tariffs are up. How do all those other actors that have won respond?
Yeah, I mean, let me take the second question. I worried very much about some of the things that Donald Trump talked about in the campaign. I mean, the Peterson Institute, the Peterson Institute had a big study looking at the economic impact if Trump did his across the board. It'd be hugely negative. And it would hurt a lot of the people who would think they would benefit, right? It's going to hurt employees. You know, companies are going to lay off people. So that is definitely not the way to go. I think the cost would be very high. I apologize. What was your first question again?
If we're in an economy that's internet.
Oh, yeah. Services are. I mean, you've actually kind of seen in the last, you know, 5-10 years, you have seen a kind of topping out of the traded part of the economy. I mean, services obviously growing faster. I don't think we're going to see that reverse, but I actually think manufacturing remains extremely important to economies. I mean, a lot of the innovation that drives our economy continues to take place in the manufacturing sector. And a lot of what we think is services, particularly high-end services, are support in various ways for manufacturing industries. So, you know, you look at the work of, you know, Gary Pisano and Willie Shih out of the Harvard Business School. I'm a real believer in the importance of manufacturing. Obviously, it's not going to be the bulk of employment in our economy. The numbers are probably going to continue to to decline. But I think if, as a society, if we're not successful in those traded sectors, I think we're not going to be as prosperous as we would be otherwise. So I think they continue to be very important.
We can't have a book called The Failure to Adjust, and then we confuse matters by having a failure to end on time. So I've been thinking of that for minutes. So I am going to shut it down here. I want to do, though, three things. One is I want to, your reward, by the way, will be, there's a reception here. Your reward is that there's books, I assume, being sold here. And really, what I want to do is congratulate that. What you've gotten is a glimpse and a taste of just how fluent he is and conversant he is in this this set of issues that's really come to the fore. And it has tremendous economic consequences, but also strategic consequences, and I think increasingly social consequences for this and other countries. So I want to just join me in congratulating him on what he's done.